Around the turn of the last century, going grocery shopping was pretty much the same as it had been for a century and more in many American cities and towns. On shopping day, if you wanted meat, you went to a meat market. If you wanted baked items like bread, you'd go to a bakery. And for all your packaged items like cereal, flour, and canned peas, you'd go to the grocer. When you entered the grocery store, you would head for the counter and hand your grocery list to one of the employees. He would then search around the walls of shelves behind the counters and gather up the items you requested. Back at the cash register, the clerk would add up the prices of all the items, you'd pay your bill, the clerk would box or bag up your purchase, and you'd head home. This all changed drastically in 1916 as a result of the big ideas and big plans of a 35-year-old big thinker named Clarence Saunders. Saunders, often described as a flamboyant P.T. Barnum type fellow, first spread the idea of the self-service grocery store widely across the land. Saunders created, named, and built the very first Piggly Wiggly store in Memphis, Tennessee. Its grand opening was September 6, 1916. Yes, Piggly Wiggly has been around that long and was the pioneer in all sorts of modern features of grocery shopping. As noted on the Piggly website, Piggly Wiggly was the first to provide checkout stands, price mark every item in the store, offer low prices through high volume, low profit margin retailing, feature a full line of nationally advertised brands, use refrigerated cases to keep produce fresher longer, and design patented fixtures and equipment to use throughout the store. In the original store, you entered through a turnstile, another thing that Clarence invented for his first Piggly store that is still in use today, everywhere from Walt Disney World to airports and sports stadiums. Then you picked up a wicker basket to carry through the store to personally pick out your items, and walked steadily forward through a maze of aisles, picking out the items on your shopping list, and maybe some on-the-spot impulse items. You ended up in the checkout lane, where the clerk would weigh any items necessary, add up the prices on the cash register, package up your purchases for you, take your payment, and off you'd go, exiting through another turnstile. Saunders Piggly Store was definitely modern and cutting edge for its time when it came to layout and procedures. But his methods of promoting all the modern conveniences were another matter. Saunders' personal style of promoting himself and his businesses was a throwback to an earlier generation, to the 19th century methods of P.T. Barnum, to whom many historians do compare Clarence. Both entrepreneurs had bigger-than-life, flamboyant personalities and were addicted to heavy-handed self-promotion and heavily exaggerated claims presented in grandiose and flowery prose that might best be labeled by the word ballyhoo, the kind of patter used by barkers at circuses and carnivals. Barnum's posters were loaded with excessive verbal and visual hyperbole. In 1881, P.T. spent the outrageous sum of $10,000 to buy a huge elephant from the London Zoo to feature in his extravaganza. Outrageous? Yes, the relative value of that purchase price in modern times would be almost $250,000. According to Barnum's ballyhoo on posters advertising his new acquisition, Jumbo was mighty lord of all beasts, largest living quadruped on earth, a towering monster, really a historic mammoth, the kingly of his mighty race. And of course, Jumbo's name and fame is tightly connected in the advertising copy to Barnum himself, as the ad concludes, "Who can be kept from waiting for Barnum and Jumbo?" Yep, Jumbo was one big elephant, although not quite as big as the illustrations and wording in Barnum's ads would strongly imply. And then, there was Gargantua the gorilla. As fate would have it, the very same year Barnum bought Jumbo, little Clarence Saunders was born. Since Jumbo died in 1885, when Clarence was only 4 years old, I would guess Clarence never saw any of those splendiferous ads. But I will bet that by the time he was old enough to read, Clarence devoured similar grandiose ads like Barnum's and other ballyhooers of that era. Because by the time he was an adult, he was writing ballyhoo like this for newspaper ads for his brand new Piggly Wiggly store. His ears have been slashed, his toes cut off, his eyes punched out, his bones broken, and his face smashed. A description of what has happened to the demon of high prices. Over his mutilated form stand scores and scores of mourners who tear at their hair and bite their fingernails while they yearn for the days when the demon of high prices ruled with an iron grip on the hungry thoughts of the consumer. Be happy that the consumer will now have a show and will henceforth, from his throne at the Piggly Wiggly, wield his scepter in the interest of his own stomach and his own pocketbook. Yes, it was old-fashioned ballyhoo tacked onto a modern style of grocery shopping, but it worked. And there was this ad from the very first year of the new Piggly too, touting the fact that prices at Piggly were so much less than other stores that shopping there was like getting a 20% salary increase. Although Clarence couldn't be satisfied with just making that logical argument. By the end of the ad, he had to embellish it with outlandish hoopla to the point of bringing God himself into the equation. It is not expected that everyone will see the wisdom of trading with Piggly Wiggly, because the maker of the universe knew that people would be of different opinions and would live different kinds of lives. There has been provided, as is told in the Bible, a hell and a heaven. Both of these words start with H, but they end differently. So considering that some people are too careless or too indifferent that they fail to get to heaven and go to another place instead, so it is expected some people will forget to go to a Piggly Wiggly store and go to some other place. Right below the Piggly Wiggly name on the front of the very first store, before he had even built his second store, Clarence had the words inscribed, "All over the world." The phrase was also on the company letterhead and other promotional literature from the start. As Clarence put it, "One day people will be proud of Memphis because of Piggly Wiggly, and it shall be said by all men, kindred, and tongues that the Piggly Wigglies shall multiply and replenish the earth with more and cleaner things to eat." In addition to flamboyant writing, Clarence made good use of planned events to call attention to his efforts. To promote the first Piggly, he arranged a gala opening with a brass band entertaining the crowds, flowers presented to every female customer, balloons for the kiddies, and a beauty contest to be judged by the advertising managers of the three local newspapers, with a total of $50 in gold as the prizes to be awarded. Also, and remember, this was 1916, he arranged for the contest to be recorded by a moving picture machine, promising the ladies who competed that the finished film would be shown at the local Memphis Picture Show theaters, and they could see their own faces up on the big screen, such as the one at the Elegant Majestic Theater on Main Street. Lots of naysayers had mocked Clarence's ideas when he first announced his plans, but he got the last laugh when he managed to franchise 1,260 stores across the country that used his patented system and the Piggly Wiggly name, which made a total of over $100 million in profits in the next 7 years. That's $1.3 billion in 2016 dollars. And Clarence Saunders profited from a cut of all those profits. Scrooge McDuck had nothing on Clarence. Within a very short time, many other grocers across the U.S. and even in other countries began imitating and building on Piggly Wiggly's self-serve procedures. Saunders became personally wealthy from his Piggly Wigglies, and in 1922 bought a 160-acre tract of land east of Memphis with plans to build for himself a lavish estate with a mansion covered in pink Georgia marble, which was eventually dubbed the Pink Palace by folks in Memphis. The mansion was to include a pipe organ, Roman atrium, indoor swimming pool in the basement, ballroom, bowling alley, billiard room, and motion picture screening room. The land was to feature tennis and handball courts, riding trails, trap shoot area, kitchen garden, and a pasture for farm animals and saddle horses. Clarence was a big fan of golf, so he included his own 18-hole golf course with a 5-acre lake. One of the holes of the course was to be on an island in the lake, and players would have to take a boat to get to it. Separate buildings would include a garage, a laundry, a refrigeration plant with cold storage room, and a pumping station and generator to provide utilities for the estate. But although Clarence was a whiz at designing grocery stores and slick at writing ballyhoo, he didn't understand high finance. In early 1923, he engaged in a major battle over Piggly Wiggly stock with various speculators on Wall Street. He eventually lost the battle. In August of 1923, the board of directors of his Piggly Wiggly Corporation accused him of reckless actions that put the company in danger of bankruptcy, and they cast him out of the company he had founded. And since they owned all the patents to the business, even the Piggly Wiggly name, Clarence was left with nothing. In February 1924, he filed for personal bankruptcy. In the midst of it all, he was forced to sell his estate and the Pink Palace Mansion, still under construction. The mansion eventually became host to the city's historical and natural history museum, with the golf course area becoming a subdivision and the lake a public park. The museum contains a detailed walkthrough model of Clarence's first Piggly Wiggly store. After Saunders' departure in 1923, the Piggly Wiggly Corporation was divided up into several units, some of which were sold to a number of regional grocery chains such as Kroger. The smaller central Piggly Wiggly Corporation, made up of many independently owned groceries licensed to do business under the Piggly Wiggly name, continued on, has been very profitable over the intervening decades, and still prospers today. There are about 600 Piggly Wigglies across the country now, most of them in small cities and towns. But back to Clarence. Clarence's dad, Abram Saunders, had been a rich plantation owner in Amherst County, Virginia before the Civil War. He fought with Stonewall Jackson, then lost everything during the war and Reconstruction period. Clarence was born in Virginia, the last of his mother's 5 children. She died when he was 5. By the time Clarence was born, his dad was a dealer in novelties. And after moving to the Clarksville, Tennessee area in 1891, former Southern gentleman Abram Saunders became just a common laborer and sharecropper. He married again, and he and his second wife, Luella, had 5 more children. The big family was desperately poor, and for a time in childhood, Clarence had to use burlap bags for shoes, even in winter. One time, a neighbor bought him a pair of shoes, and once he became rich, he sent the man a $100 bill every Christmas to show his gratitude. Clarence did back-breaking labor in the tobacco fields with his dad from an early age. He had less than 2 years of schooling and was mocked by the other students as the barefoot boy. But from the age of 9, Clarence's real biography sounds like the rags-to-riches stories of the fictional Horatio Alger books of the time. He decided the way out of his family's lifestyle was to apply himself with diligence to whatever opportunities came to him. By 11, he worked in the summer at a sawmill and a limestone kiln, making 25 cents a day for 11 hours work. By 14, he was offered his first real job at a general store for $4 a month plus room and board. In defiance of his dad, he accepted the offer, left school and home, and worked 15-hour days. His employer was so impressed with Clarence's work ethic that he doubled his salary in 6 months. Clarence tried to excel at every job, learn as much as he could, then move on and up. Realizing more education would greatly increase his potential for success, he began reading voraciously and studied math. By age 22, he was making $90 a month and got married to his first wife, Carolyn. He eventually worked his way up to a position as a successful traveling salesman for wholesale grocery companies. By 1915, at 34, he became partner in a new wholesale business and lived in a large home in the most fashionable neighborhood in Memphis, Tennessee. And within a year, he had moved on from the wholesale business to inventing the first wildly successful self-serve grocery store chain. As you can see from this brief glimpse of Clarence's background, it was not in Clarence's nature to let anything get in the way of moving on and up. He had never been a quitter, and he wasn't about to start just because of the loss of his Piggly Wiggly business. He still had his boundless optimism, his entrepreneurial skills, and, like W.C. Fields, he still had the gift of ballyhoo. So, shortly after filing bankruptcy in 1924, he announced plans to start another grocery store chain, saying, "I must make a living. I will open up a new store in 50 days. My new chain of stores will be just as big a success as my first creation, Piggly Wiggly." Irked that the very name he had created, Piggly Wiggly, had been stolen from him, he decided to name his new chain the Clarence Saunders, Sole Owner of My Name Stores. Most folks referred to the stores as sole owner stores. The grand opening of his first new store came on March 30th, 1924. Just like the first Piggly Wiggly grand opening, Clarence was there handing out carnations, and this time a jazz band was perched on top of a large icebox unit playing hit tunes. In a ballyhoo ad not long after that grand opening, he noted, "I have cut out of my desire and thoughts every former affection I had for Piggly Wiggly. To me now the word is obnoxious, and so much so that if every Piggly Wiggly store was offered to me as a gift, plus $1 million in cash, I would refuse to accept. This is my Monday washing, and I am done." Amazingly, within a year, Clarence built the sole owner chain up to 675 stores, with annual sales of $60 million. It wasn't just a clone of the Piggly Wiggly stores either. Although most of the store was self-serve, he added helpful clerks back into the equation for the new fresh food sections he had added, including a meat department, a deli department, and a bakery making fresh baked goods. At the top of his game again, in 1928, he bought 300 acres of woods and pasture land 10 miles east of Memphis and created a new estate he called Woodlands. He included even more elaborate golf course plans this time. His 18-hole course was 7,200 yards in length, making it the longest one in the world at the time of its construction. He opened it for public play in 1931. Also on the estate were tennis courts, riding paths, a landing strip for his several airplanes, a 17-acre lake, and an outdoor swimming pool. The estate mansion had all the modern conveniences he was addicted to, including electric lights in the closets that turned on automatically when the closet door was open. Unfortunately, his wife Carolyn and their three children didn't get to enjoy the new family home. On September 27, 1928, the eve of their 25th anniversary, wife Carolyn filed for divorce. Although smiling all the time for his customers, behind the scenes, Clarence had a volatile temper. Clarence didn't contest the divorce, and 3 months later, he married his second wife, Patricia, age 29. But back in Clarence's business world, he continued opening stores and writing ballyhoo, including this "Once I Was Dead" ad for a grand opening of a store in Rusk, Texas in 1929. Once I was rich and had a lot of Piggly Wiggly stores. My success begot envy, and the schemes of my trusted friends reached out to enmesh me and take from me my Piggly Wiggly business. They got it and broke me flat. Then they said, "Dead is Saunders. No more will he have stores and friends. He's dead. No more will he sell groceries and meats cheap." That's when I got sick and tired of all the dead talk. So I got busy in a hurry and started me some new stores. This new store of mine is the prettiest of them all. It is distinctively a Saunders store. So convenient and so clean. It's a real beauty. Don't fail to come and see for yourself the prettiest store of them all. And remember, folks, Clarence Saunders, the dead man, is very much alive and wears on his face the smile that won't come off. Toward the end of the heyday of the sole owner chain, Clarence Saunders even became sole owner of a professional football team, the Tigers of Memphis. It wasn't part of the new National Football League that had been formed in 1920, but it did play exhibition games with teams from that league, including the Chicago Bears and the Green Bay Packers. Football legend Red Grange came to town with the Bears to play the Tigers in late 1929 and made several personal appearances with Clarence, including radio interviews, providing great publicity for the sole owner stores. The publicity was almost as great for the December 15, 1929 Tiger game in Memphis against the Green Bay team. The Packers had just won the National League Championship on December 8th in Chicago after a perfect season with no losses. Imagine everyone's surprise when they lost the very next weekend to the Clarence Saunders sole owner Tigers. Clarence couldn't resist indulging in ballyhoo, claiming that this actually made the Tigers the real national champions. Yes, Clarence Saunders was at the top of his game, riding high again. But then came the Black Friday stock market crash on October 24th, 1929, which led to the Great Depression. The new chain didn't survive the downward spiral of the economy. On June 16, 1931, Clarence filed for bankruptcy. He lost the big chain of stores, but he wasn't down and out yet. Before the bankruptcy proceedings were even complete, he was already finding backers for a new plan he had to open up a much bigger version of his earlier stores, more like a modern supermarket. On October 17, 1931, just 4 months after he declared bankruptcy for the sole owner corporation, his new Clarence Saunders store opened in Memphis. This time it was in a three-story building the size of a department store, with Clarence's usual hoopla. The grand opening was broadcast on local radio, with a band outside the store playing "Happy Days Are Here Again," and a speech from Clarence in which he said, "I know many of you came out of curiosity. I'm curious too, curious to see how long I could keep going broke and still keep coming back." The new store included a bakery and a meat department featuring his latest innovative idea, meat individually packaged in cellophane wrap and displayed in open refrigerators. Back at home, Pat gave birth to their only daughter, Anne, in the Woodlands mansion in 1932, just months before they were forced to move out of Woodlands because of the sole owner corporation bankruptcy. But nothing slowed Clarence down. He soon announced new expansion plans for his latest retail ventures. And thus, in early March, ground was broken at a new site in a Memphis suburban neighborhood for what he called his mammoth store. It was to be a two-story building with 60,000 square feet of space and 20 checkout stands. In addition to groceries, Clarence hoped to sell auto supplies, drugs, cosmetics, and more. A foundation and basement were quickly constructed, but within weeks, work was stopped because Clarence couldn't pay the contractors. Instead of Saunders Mammoth Store, the site permanently became known to folks around Memphis as Saunders Basement. But even that didn't stop him. Before the end of 1932, he rented an abandoned post office on Union Avenue that connected Memphis with eastern suburbs and converted it to a 12,000 square foot store, equal in size to 25 of his original Piggly Wiggly's. It was large enough for a bakery with revolving ovens, a soda fountain, and a meat department. Unfortunately, Clarence could not foresee the election in fall 1932 of Franklin Roosevelt and the national plans FDR would be putting in place shortly after his inauguration in March 1933. Those plans included establishing the NRA in June 1933 with its minimum wage and maximum workday controls. Clarence was actually supportive of FDR and the New Deal and accepted the NRA standards, but soon realized that he just could not meet those standards and still make a profit on his stores. Before the end of the year, he closed both of the stores. But still, Clarence never gave up his dreams. They only got more grandiose. And that brings us to Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon. Buck was first introduced in a magazine story in 1928, which was almost immediately spun out into a daily newspaper comic strip. His backstory is that shortly after flying airplanes for the U.S. in World War I, he got a job surveying and ended up trapped in a cave-in of an abandoned mine. Unconscious and affected by a strange gas in the mine, he remains in suspended animation for 500 years and wakes up in the year 2429. During his long sleep, a major war leaves America occupied and dominated by Asiatic overlords. He emerges from the ground into a world of space travel and fantastic technology and joins the rebel forces of the subjugated Americans with his trusty sidekick, Wilma Deering. Buck and Wilma went on to star in a weekly comic strip, comic books, movie serials starring Buster Crabbe, a radio program, and eventually a TV show. Oh, and to spawn a collection of toys. Lots of toys. Flash was introduced in 1934 in a wildly popular sci-fi newspaper comic strip. Strangely enough, Flash didn't start out as an astronaut or even an airline pilot like Buck. Flash was a polo player with a degree from Yale in some unnamed subject. He just happens to be kidnapped by the first earthly inventor of a rocket ship and taken to a futuristic world on another planet. Adventures, of course, accompanied by his trusty sidekick, Dale Arden. And Flash went on to star in comic books, radio serials, movie serials, also starring Buster Crabbe, and eventually a TV show. All of which, of course, also spawned a collection of toys. Lots of toys. Buck and Flash were introduced as existing in alternate universes of a wonderfully futuristic, high-tech environment. Yet Earth in 1940 wasn't all that futuristic in most places. I would suggest to you that if Buck and Flash were able to enter the world of the U.S. in the late 1940s, their choice for doing their grocery shopping would have been at a Clarence Saunders chain grocery store. No, not Piggly Wiggly, not a sole owner store. No, Buck and Flash would have been right at home in Clarence's next entry into his race to the future of grocery shopping, the Keedoozles store. When I first heard of these stores, I honestly thought it was a spoof on something. Surely no serious businessman would have named a grocery store Keedoozle. But that was before I heard of the man who named his earlier stores first Piggly Wiggly and then Clarence Saunders, sole owner of my name, stores. Such a man was capable of coming up with any weird name he wanted to use. So Keedoozle it was. And futuristic it was. Saunders' first experimental Keedoozle store opened to the public in May 1937. Sample food items were displayed behind glass windows, just like soda can dispensing machines today. Each shopper was given a special gadget to poke in the hole next to each item she wanted, which sent electrical signals to a back room, where the ordered items were gathered together to deliver to her via conveyor belt when her order was complete. But the new gadgets and equipment Clarence had invented to make all this possible had so many technical problems that he had to close the store within a few months and refine the process. It opened again in May 1938, closed in October to work out even more bugs, then opened again in February 1939. By October 1939, Clarence decided that and he was now ready for a real grand opening. And Clarence was still determined to sell the future of grocery shopping with the P.T. Barnum-style ballyhoo of the past, as you can immediately tell from this 1939 grand opening ad. For it's time for love and kisses when there is to happen the most glorious time of one's life. If in one is a heart, let it beat faster. If in one is love, let it be a fire that burns. We shall kiss, we shall love. For the new Keedoozle, which opens tomorrow, Saturday, will so startle the world that he who is dumb will speak and he who is deaf will hear. Fresh as the dew of a spring morn, that is Keedoozle. Beautiful beyond all imagination, that is Keedoozle. If you don't feel like loving and kissing before, you most assuredly will after you see Keedoozle. For it so dazzles with its beauty that even the stars will blink to behold such brilliance on earth. He closed the small experimental store and on December 8, 1939, opened a lavish new store in a three-story building in downtown Memphis. It had parking next to it for 300 cars and a luxurious powder room for ladies with a uniformed maid. He planned to use one of the floors as the workshop to build Keedoozle machinery for future franchisees. But the store remained open for just a year with continual technical problems. Clarence closed it in December 1940, and the IRS seized assets from the corporation to pay 3 years of back taxes. Clarence would likely have continued trying to make improvements in his Keedoozle plans, form a new corporation, and open again soon, but World War II intervened. With metal and electrical materials rationed for the war effort, he had to postpone his plans. To keep busy during the war, Clarence converted a bowling alley into a large woodwork shop, manufacturing such things as toy wagons and baby strollers. He did much of the work himself with as little machinery and materials as possible. He even used scrapped wood to make broomsticks. Still, it was obvious that Clarence's mind never quit churning during the war years, and as soon as the war was over, he got right back to his Keedoozle planning. By 1948, he was convinced he'd beaten the pre-war technological problems that kept plaguing the Keedoozle store plans. He'd created even more elaborate gadgets and equipment, debugged them, and on August 19, 1948, he opened a brand new incarnation of the Keedoozle. This time around, he even came up with a simple prefab building design to be used for every Keedoozle store, constructed primarily of sheet metal on a concrete slab, modeled directly from the wartime Quonset huts used by the military. With the grand opening, he peppered the media with his usual grandiose descriptions of his plans and his expectations. In a Life magazine interview published in the January 3, 1949 edition, he noted that he planned to sell the equipment necessary to set up a Keedoozle store for $50,000 to franchisees. He would oversee their operations and charge them 0.5% to 1% of their gross for the use of the Keedoozle name. And in 5 years, there will be 1,000 Keedoozles throughout the United States selling $5 billion worth of goods. And don't forget, that is $5 billion in 1949 dollars, which would be over $50 billion in 2016. So, just how did the new Keedoozle store work? The Piggly Wiggly had been a self-serve store in the sense that customers wandered around and gathered their own items. The new Keedoozle went far, far beyond that into the sci-fi future, and far beyond what one would have expected would have been possible in the pre-computer days of 1948. Picture Flash Gordon going into a Keedoozle store to get his grub for his next space trip. Usually he carries a ray gun, such as this one. Here's what one of those looked like up close. But he'd put away his laser to go shopping, for when he gets to the Keedoozle store, a helpful clerk would give him a vaguely similar weapon, often referred to as a key. What would he do with that key? Here's how the Life magazine article describes the procedure. Keedoozle is almost completely automatic. On entering, the customer takes a key, an aluminum mechanism that holds a roll of paper tape, two display cases containing samples of all goods sold, a key like the one this lady is holding, or the one held here by Clarence himself. For each purchase, she puts the key in the slot, presses a button. This records her purchase on the tape by punching a pattern of holes. If you could see these pictures closely enough, you'd see that each food item is labeled much like goodies are often labeled in candy dispensing machines these days, with a letter and a number, like H3 or B6. In front of each of the key slots are two rows of buttons, and I assume one has letters, the other numbers, so the shopper can key in the correct combination for the bottle of prune juice or box of cornflakes she wants. Information from each key-in is sent electronically to a large storeroom hidden behind the glass cases, where racks and stacks of canned, bagged, and boxed goods are tended by workers who compile the individual requests. Some of this process is automated by drop-down chutes and conveyor belts that are triggered by the signals from the key. Some of it is just done by hand. When her complete order has been punched on the tape, she takes the key to the cashier at the front of the store. The cashier has a gadget that translates the punched holes and reads how much is owed. And an electrical signal is sent to the storeroom, which tells a conveyor belt to propel the completed and bagged order to the front of the store, where the customer is waiting in the pleasant lounge near the door. But for all of Clarence's hoopla, it didn't pan out that way. As Time magazine put it in an article in the August 29, 1949 issue, last month, Saunders' one and only Keedoozle in Memphis went kerplunk. In 11 months, Saunders had lost $170,000. Said he, Keedoozle was too much for the average mind to comprehend. Besides attracting too few customers, it cost too much to run the calculators and conveyor belts. The bottom line seems to have been also that the primitive computing abilities of the equipment used in the stores, much of it invented by Clarence himself, just wasn't up to the pressure of dealing with the volume of business necessary to make a profit. It kept having glitches and mixing up orders. And the mechanical aspects of the process, much of it also invented by Clarence, sometimes failed miserably too. The Life magazine article noted that this included the time a reporter doing a story on the store was almost killed by an avalanche of canned turnips in the back room area. Yes, I think Flash would have loved the futuristic Keedoozles store, but maybe not after his order for his space trip got mixed up with Mrs. Smith's groceries for her upcoming Ladies Club tea party. And what happened to Clarence after the Keedoozles kerflop? The same thing that always happened. It was not in Clarence's nature to ever give up. He got up, dusted himself off, and immediately began working on plans for his next venture. On August 18, 1949, Clarence announced the details of his next venture, opening a zizz-buzz store in the defunct Keedoozles building. There would be push buttons involved in selecting items, but most of the other automated features would be gone, waiting for some time in the future when the average mind could catch up to his space-age ideas. But alas, for some reason, nothing came of those zizz-buzz plans. There is no evidence such a store was ever opened. But again, Clarence wasn't about to give up. He went right back to developing plans for another automatic store system. This one he called the Food Electric. The first such store was to be located just two blocks from the original Piggly Wiggly location in Memphis. Here's how he described his plans. The store operates so automatically that the customer can collect her groceries herself, wrap them, and act as her own cashier. It eliminates the checkout crush, cuts overhead expenses, and enables a small staff to handle a tremendous volume. I can handle a $2 million volume with only 8 employees. To make this happen, Clarence had invented another gadget, essentially a primitive computer or shopping brain, as he referred to it. Like the Keedoozles key, the Food Electric gadget would be entered into a slot in front of a window showing a can of beans. The brain would tell the dispenser to pop a can of that kind of beans into a chute and drop it out to the customer. The brain would record the price of the item and keep a running total of each of the items the customer selected to receive throughout the store, displayed in a window in the gadget. When done, she would wrap or bag her items herself, hand the gadget to the person at the cash register, pay her bill, and be on her way. Yes, Clarence couldn't quit. For after all, if Clarence gave up his never-ending schemes for inventing the greatest grocery stores in the universe, where would Buck and Wilma and Flash and Dale go grocery shopping? No, Clarence had to keep going no matter what. Because by the time Flash finished conquering the universe, Clarence would be out there to meet him with a chain of intergalactic, super-duper, fully automated grocery stores. But alas, like the Fizzbuzz, the Food Electric store was never to be. Clarence Saunders died on October 14, 1953, before plans were completed. He was 72 years old. Whatever splendiferous technological improvements he may have had in mind for the Food Electric stores died with him. Yes, Clarence was a man way ahead of his time. Oh, many of his innovations, starting with the self-serve idea of the Piggly Wiggly in 1916, were adopted throughout the grocery store industry during his lifetime. But as for those crazy Food Electric ideas of customers even becoming their own cashiers, it would take another 40 years or so after his death for the industry and computerized technology to catch up to Clarence's visions. Early prototypes of the computerized self-checkout station were available in some stores by the early 1990s. Customers could scan the prices of a basket full of items one at a time, bag them, then pay for them all with no help from any grocery store staff. It took a few years to get a large segment of the public used to the idea of being their own cashier and bagger, but almost all large stores now feature a lane or two of self-checkouts. And more recently, we've come even closer to Clarence's Food Electric idea. Stores such as Giant Foods literally loan you a little brain when you come in the store to carry around with you as you shop. You take along a stack of empty grocery bags, and scan and bag your items right as you wander the aisles, just as you would have in a food electric store. You can see a running total in a window on the brain of what you are spending as you pick up each item. When done, you return the brain to the employee at the front of the store and pay the total shown. Perhaps Clarence would be pleased to know the average mind has finally caught up to being able to comprehend such a level of high-tech shopping. Although not everyone might agree with that assessment.